You know, you spend like 10 years of your life doing something and then it doesn't work. And like, what then? I like thought about all the other people who have built anything and the like difficulties and disasters that they've had to go through. But that really the important thing is to keep going. My name is Erika Hamden. I'm a professor of astrophysics at the University of Arizona. Usually when people think of professors, they're like, oh, you teach and you like sit in your office and think about things. But my like real passions are in like creating something. A lot of astronomy, you can't like run experiments and you can't really go to the places that you would like to observe. So a lot of times you're dealing with just like data and like pixels on a screen, but there has to be someone who actually builds the telescope to collect all that data, and so that's what I do. In general, if you can avoid building a new telescope, you should do that because it's really complicated and difficult and expensive. So there are a lot of like fantastic telescopes. There's, you know, all the telescopes that are outside of Tucson on Kitt Peak, and those are great. But sometimes people have like a science question and there's no way to answer it with existing telescopes. And so basically that is the only reason that you should ever build a telescope, is because there's no other way to get the data that you need. So for me, the subject that I'm most interested in is these like very, very, very giant and very faint clouds of hydrogen that are outside of, we think, most galaxies. And the "we think" is the important part, because like we don't really know, but we know that all this hydrogen was formed in the Big Bang and then it starts to condense and collapse. And in places where it collapses, that's where it forms galaxies. But we also know that if that were the end of it, the galaxy forms and then it makes stars, there wouldn't really be any stars left because that process would have been over. And so we know that there has to be more hydrogen coming into all of these galaxies to just like keep them alive. So Fireball, the telescope that I helped build, is designed specifically to just look at that hydrogen. Okay, so Fireball stands for the Faint Intergalactic Medium Redshifted Emission Balloon, which is a lot. Although I think Fireball is a really good name, but the acronym is like pretty tortured. It flies on a high altitude balloon out of New Mexico. The balloon is because the wavelength that we're looking at is totally blocked by the Earth's atmosphere. And so you either have to put your telescope in space in orbit or put it on a balloon where it's above most of the atmosphere. So we get pretty good transmission if we're up at like 130,000 feet, which is where the balloons go to. But then because it's on a balloon, it only stays up for one day. And so we do one night of observing and then it comes down. I have been into space as like a general thing basically my whole life. When I was a little kid, I was in like second grade and my mom told me that there was a contest on television that scientists wanted people to come up with a new name for the Big Bang. And I looked at her and I was like, well, I don't know what the Big Bang is, because I was in second grade. And she was in the middle of making dinner, so she was like, oh, go look it up. And I like went upstairs to our encyclopedia and I looked up what the Big Bang was, and I was like, oh my God, this is so cool. And I had never thought about like the universe or space or anything, and I remember reading it, and then in the back of the encyclopedia in the last volume, there was an atlas. And at the back of the atlas, there was like a map of the solar system and then a map of the galaxy and a map of the known universe. And I remember looking at the page of the known universe and being like, oh my God, this is crazy. I like really liked school and I liked learning, and I was like a pretty nerdy kid, as you might not be surprised to learn. I wanted to be an astronaut. And so when I was applying for college, I wanted to go to MIT because like lots of astronauts go to MIT. You know, MIT felt like this place of like all sorts of discoveries and science. And I got there and I had a really terrible time. And it was like pretty heartbreaking in a lot of ways. MIT at the time was a lot more of like a pressure cooker. I started getting these like panic attacks and anxiety, which I'd never experienced before. The day after Thanksgiving, I called my parents, say I was like, I don't want to be here. And I spent the rest of that year kind of like rebuilding my sense of self. because I had felt like, oh, I had really failed. I went back to college the following year, and I made it the number one priority to like be happy and to make decisions that were focused on like what did I want and what did I care about and not really what everybody else thought I should be doing. I was a postdoc at Caltech for 4 years, and the professor that I worked with there actually came up with the idea for Fireball. By the time we got out to the field to do the flight campaign, I was running the entire project. We all got to the airport where we do the launches at like 11 p.m. And then we worked all night to get it ready, and then you just wait. Around like 10:30 in the morning, they started inflating the balloon, which is sort of the point of no return. At that point, I remember feeling like, oh my God, this is really happening. Like, it had been so long and so much effort that you like work on something and you kind of feel like this, it's never gonna go anywhere. And then I remember like, you know, standing there watching the balloon fill up with helium, and then they released it, and then the telescope flew into the air. It takes a couple hours to go up to the altitude. So the balloon is illuminated during the day and it gets pretty hot from just the light of the sun. And then at night it will cool off, and as it cools off, it shrinks a little bit because the gas inside also cools off. And then it typically loses altitude, but normally like 10,000 feet of altitude. You know, sunset happens and it's dropping, and then we're starting to take data, and I would check every so often and read out what the altitude was. And it kept going down, and I was like, this seems kind of weird, but like, I don't know, I have too many other things to think about. And then around 9 o'clock, the balloon people, so there's a whole separate group of NASA people who just do the balloon launches. So I call them the balloon people. The main guy came down from where they were doing their work, and he was like, we think that there's something wrong, but we're not sure. And then about an hour later, they came back and they said, we think there's a hole in the balloon. And I remember them when they told us, and I just felt like, oh, I do not have the emotional range to like run this and deal with this news at the same time. And so I didn't really feel bad about it until the next day after we all went home. And then I woke up and I was like, I cannot believe that this happened. That was like the best day and the worst day of my life, I think. There's some very experienced scientists who have done other flights, other balloon flights, and one of them, the next day, he said to me, so when are we going again? And like, he was ready the next day. And it took me a little longer to get there. What keeps me going is making sure that I'm happy in the stuff that I'm doing every day. It's very easy to push through kind of a bad experience if you're like, well, way in the future or sometime in the future, there's gonna be a payoff. I think I've learned just from like even really early days of working on things that like that payoff is not promised. And so if you're waiting for it, like that's a bad idea. What you have to do is like be happy with how things are each day so that even if the payoff never comes, you can still keep going or you still feel like it will have been worth it. I have a very serious yoga practice, so I do yoga every day for about an hour, and that makes me feel really good. I'm trying to be able to do a handstand, like a freestanding handstand in the middle of the room, which is very hard, but one day I'll get there. In an ideal world, failure would be present in everything. I think that there's a lot more latitude for failure in science because it's such a huge part of the scientific method and like the philosophy of science. Ultimately, failure is trying something new and then it not working out. And like, just because it doesn't work out doesn't mean that trying something new wasn't a good way to go or that you shouldn't keep trying new things. And I think that kind of philosophy of like exploration and discovery is really, could be really valuable in all sorts of aspects of life. Even, you know, talking about it as failure, like, is sort of a misnomer, I think, for what you're actually doing. You can like phrase it in a positive way. And not necessarily that it didn't work out, it only doesn't work out if you stop.